Nat Segeloff is our resident film buff, and he's also worked a good deal with William Friedkin, so we thought we'd just let him loose on the Brink set.
Thanks, Robin. You know, they say a movie director is a person who presides over accidents. There are very few accidents on a William Friedkin film. When he made The French Connection, he put the period at the end of the sentence on movie chases and won an Academy Award for directing it. He made us sweat blood for Sorcerer, and he scared hell into us for The Exorcist. And now, he, Peter Falk, and a group of talented actors and technicians are pulling off the Brink's job. Among modern film directors, William Friedkin is considered the most realistic. His films almost look like news footage, which fits because his background is TV and documentaries. In fact, he and production designer Dean Tavalaris have gone the limits in turning their dreams into reality.
You're inside the actual spot where the Brink's vault was when it was robbed in 1950. This is the building, this is the same door, and this is the room in here. Everything that you see here is an exact reconstruction of the way the vault room was when it was robbed. Now, for a good number of years, it wasn't like this. This place was empty, it was kind of a ruin. And was just sort of an empty garage. And what we did was, according to the old plans, we recreated this room and the counting rooms and the rooms where the trucks are kept and everything else exactly according to specifications. So that this area is where the safe was, and it was exactly in this spot, in this room, 28 years ago.
To reenact the robbery, Friedkin has chosen actors who would probably flatter their real-life counterparts. Peter Falk stars as Tony Pino, their leader. Warren Oates plays Specs O'Keefe. Paul Sorvino is Jazz Maffey. And Alan Gurwitz is Tony Pino's brother-in-law, Vinny Costa.
Your films always feature strong performances. Why?
I've just been very fortunate in the actors I've worked with, really. I've worked with people sometimes at a point in their career when they were very hungry. I mean, a lot of people come to a set and they just doing time. You know, they come to a motion picture set or to any job and they're just doing it. And then there's other people who at either a given point in their life or throughout their lives are just hungry and filled with a sense of wanting to make it. That was Gene Hackman in The French Connection. He had tremendous desire. He wanted every moment of every take to be the best that he could do.
Dr. Klein.
Yes, I'm Dr. Klein.
It was true of Roy Scheider in that picture, and everybody I worked with on The Exorcist. Fortunately, we found each other at a moment when everybody had that desire.
That was
riddling.
Great doctors.
Help her, please! Help her, please! Help her, please! Help it! Stop! It's burning! It's
burning! There's something, Mother. Doctor, please help her!
I'm never thinking of what is the audience going to do at this particular moment, because directing is telling a story in the same way that a guy who draws a comic book is telling a story frame by frame by frame. And directing is telling a story shot by shot by shot. And each shot adds a little bit more to the clarity of the scene and ultimately the overall story.
Nice and easy. Take your time.
And here's a crucial part of the story, as evening's cameras invade that innermost stronghold and go behind the scenes of a closed set.
Action.
What that means? You take her any Friday, it's a million each.
Who'd ever thought they kept that kind of dough in here?
Nobody would have thought. Except me and my brother-in-law, Tony Pino, the greatest thief who ever lived. My mother's
It's really hard to say what I was looking for. Something that subjectively was more spontaneous and a little more sort of real in the terms of the sense of amazement when these guys realized, as they actually did at one point when they first went into this vault room, they realized exactly how much money they were talking about. And they never knew initially that they were talking about millions of dollars.
Every time you make a film, you start a trend. Police films, demon films.
I think my trend-setting days may be behind me. I thought that my last film, Sorcerer, which was a failure critically and at the box office, was the best film that I've made. So you never really know. You know, you do stories that interest you, and you let the chips fall where they may. And sometimes in this film, what I'm trying to do is mix farce, fantasy, and reality. Because frankly, the reason I'm trying to do that is because I think that's the best blend in a motion picture. A combination of all of those elements, which is, if I were to, you know, take a perspective on life itself, I think it's equal parts of farce, fantasy, and reality. My own, anyway.
Nat, they transported tea kettles, they built above the ground subway stations. It must have been a phenomenal amount of money. How much did it cost to make Brinks?
Brinks for $12 million, folks.
Oh, boy. And how much could a movie like that gross if it does well?
Oh, $30, $40, $50 million, maybe just to break even.
And how much did the robbers get?
$2.7 million.
Oh, I bet they wish they'd gone into filmmaking and not the business of heisting.
It's a lot safer, I think.
It certainly is. Pleasure working with you.